Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Social Security Committee. We have two items on the agenda today, and I'd like to welcome our guests as well. Agenda item one is a decision in taking business in private. Can we agree to take items three and four in private? Committee agreed? Thank you very much. Agenda item two is universal credit rollout. And I'd like to welcome the witnesses from the Department for Work and Pensions, Neil Cooling, Universal Credit Director General, and Denise Horsfall, Scotland Work Services Director. Mr. Coolings, I believe that you wanted to give a 5-minute presentation.
Oh, it's very kind of you, convener. Just a sort of a couple of points I'd like to make before we undoubtedly get into the detail. The first thing I'd like to just emphasise, and I know you've been to Musselburgh, so some of you have seen Universal Credit in action. You may have seen it in your own constituencies as well. This is, I used to say, is the biggest change programme across the United Kingdom that the government is trying to do before the events of the middle of this year. I think we're probably second now. But it is a huge undertaking, and the way we've been approaching it is something, a sort of bit of shorthand we use, is called test and learn. Well, we've been trying to roll it out at a steady pace, keeping it small, so that we learn from the experiences that we are that we get. Because our previous approach is to rolling out big change, and we've not tried anything this big really since the creation of the welfare state, has been that you get locked into ways of working where you've sunk lots of money and costs, and it is very difficult to then move away from that. So we've typically gone, what outside commentators have said is slow. That's been a deliberate act. And you will have seen last year that in our first year, we rolled out 10 job centres. This time last year, I was rolling out 40 job centres a week in terms of the ability, once you've worked out what the reactions to your system are by claimants and other customers, then you can then safely go to scale. And that's exactly what we've been doing in Musselburgh and other parts of the United Kingdom as well, in terms of testing this small, seeing what the reactions are, and learning from it. So that's worth understanding when we, I think, come into some of the detail. The second thing I'd say is that we've got some very interesting data on the outcomes, which encourages me as the person responsible for rolling this out, that again, in the kind of examination perhaps of what's going wrong, we might just focus a little bit on what's going right. And we've set up basically a comparative study that we've kept rolling. And it compares outcomes for the job seekers allowance regime for outcomes you're getting on universal credit. Now, the OECD thinks that job seekers allowance is one of the most effective, if the most effective, way of helping people into work across the developed world. And universal credit compared to that is producing outcomes in excess of that, which strikes me as actually quite remarkable for this stage of the program. For every 100 people who get a job in the first 9 months of their job seekers allowance claim, 113 people are getting a job on universal credit. Now that's matched, so they're like groups of claimants looking at the liked outcomes, and we've had the methodology for this peer-reviewed by NISA, the National Institute for Economic and Social Research. So it's not just us saying this. And that, you know, is fundamentally what the reform is about. It's about trying to encourage people into work and support them more effectively. So effectively, what's going on in those first 9 months? They are finding work quicker, they're staying in work longer, and more of them are finding work, which is, you know, quite encouraging. Now, we're keeping those studies going. We intend to produce them regularly as we expand the numbers of people on universal credit. We'll expand that and see what kind of labour market effects we're getting. But that's a very encouraging start for the programme. And in a lot of the noise you hear about universal credit, I don't think that really gets that much kind of focus. So those are the two things, convener, I really wanted to say by way of sort of clearing my throat at the start of this.
Okay. Thank you very much. That if I could just start off, you mentioned about the universal credit, the rollout being the biggest change programme in your introduction, and obviously testing and learning. Do you have a timetable for the rollout of the services? We're looking at two different services, one running alongside each other at the moment, which is causing difficulties. You know, the digital as well. Do you have a timetable for the Scottish rollout?
So we published a couple of weeks ago now a timetable up to and including September 2018 that lists all of the job centres and all the local authorities across Great Britain where the service will be rolling out. And about a week ago, the Northern Ireland government, because it's devolved in Northern Ireland, announced their parallel plans from September 17 to September 18 for the rollout there. So I'm very happy to share that list for Scotland with the committee if you haven't seen it.
Yeah. Thank you. Just a follow-up question to that. We know that Glasgow has the largest amount of universal credit claimants, and the rollout, I believe, is going to be one of the last in Glasgow. I just wonder what you perceive to be any difficulties there, and obviously, and I know that the committee want to come in on this as well, in regards to the job closure, the job centre closure, 50% in Glasgow, how that would have a knock-on effect in this particular rollout.
So, in effect, the kind of key date in the rollout is in October 17. In October 17, you know, I spoke about how we've kept it small whilst we learn, and we're roughly, on average, between now and October 17, we do about 5 job centres a month across Great Britain, and there are about 8, I think, Scottish job centres in that sort of phase going on. In October 17, we step up the pace to roughly, and it varies each month, to around 55 to 60 job centres a month. That's what I mean by going to scale. And essentially what we've done across Great Britain is of the 712 job centres, if we've still got 712, I think it's about the right number, then they've all got a schedule point in that period from October 17 to September 18. And we've spoken locally with Denise and her equivalents in the other parts of Great Britain to say, what to you looks like the most optimal order for doing this? I need to get it done. I need to try and level it out across the country because I've got to train people and keep the existing services going whilst we do this. What looks optimal for you? So that's why the shape of the rollout in Scotland is as it is, because it responds to the advice I've got from people working in Scotland saying this is the best way of doing it in Scotland.
Just to pick up on that particular point, we visited Musselburgh Job Centre, and you know, we obviously had witnesses as well, and they're telling us there's difficulties with the two types. They're saying that it's very difficult to keep up with the changes to the system, particularly two different systems in Universal Credit, which are in operation at the moment. And yet, even though we visited just 2 weeks ago, I think it was, we were never made aware of the job closures, of the job centre closures.
Yeah.
So it must have been done, you know, not just 2 weeks ago or last week. It had to have been done and on the agenda for a number of months. So maybe I'm directing it to yourself or Denise Horsfall. But we were never given any indication whilst we were visiting the job
Let me explain something about, two questions there, Convene, or two points. The first one is we have the live service that we are running in parallel with our new full service, which is, you saw the full service in Musselburgh, and that's the rollout I'm talking about coming in the next 18 months or so to everywhere in Great Britain. As part of that, and we've done this in Musselburgh, we move people off of the live service onto the full service, so there is only one system working there. But in other parts of the country at the moment, for example, Inverness, you know, we haven't done that exercise yet, but that is part of the plan to roll us on. Now, I'll bring Denise in a minute to talk to you about the specifics of Glasgow, but it is worth understanding that for the Department for Work and Pensions, we're in about 1,000 properties across Great Britain, and we had in I think it was 1998 actually, it was. I can't say the last Conservative government, but the Conservative government started this process and the Labour government took it on, so it finished, it straddled that change of government. But we signed a 20-year deal in 1998 on these properties for long-term leasing kind of arrangements. And that deal was coming to an end is coming to an end in 2018. So we have been negotiating with not 1,000 landlords, but a very large number of landlords, some direct with the people we took the 20-year deal out with, and some with individual landlords where they own the titles to the buildings. That's a very complicated commercial discussion. And because of some of the commerciality about that, that's very difficult to do in an open forum. Because if the person you're negotiating with knows you want to be in property X or property Y, the price of it will go up. So we've been trying to secure the best deal for the government, you know, the taxpayers and the like, in terms of that, because our general view of things were 20 years on, we were paying over the odds for the accommodation we were in. We also wanted to take some opportunities to try and co-locate and with some local authorities. We've been successful in some of that. But again, if the landlords knew what we were doing in location X, they could work out what we were doing in location Y. So things were kept, cards were kept very close to our chest for those reasons.
Happily coming about Glasgow specifically. So, convener, yes, we didn't talk about it. I made reference to the fact that we were looking at estate, but I certainly wasn't specific when we met. It wasn't in my gift to be specific at that stage. I had no authority to actually talk to you about it. My authority came on the day of release. That's where my authority came. So the 50%, just to put it into context, we've got a highest density of job centres in Glasgow compared to other large cities across the country, across the UK. We can't do some of our activities in those sites, so our smaller sites don't allow us to bring partners in, don't allow us to bring some of the employers in. We just haven't got the space. But in fact, then I've got large amount of space in other places, such as the retention sites that we've been talking about. So we looked at what was felt to be an appropriate and a reasonable travel distance between sites. Settled on some anchor sites, some sites that we're retaining, and then looked at the travel distances from the smaller sites where we just can't do the business, but we could absorb the business into the retained sites. So that's pretty much the picture. Now, I can go through every single site if you want me to. As sure everybody knows by now. But the principle is very much about trying to be reasonable about the amount of distance between sites that people have to travel. Five out of the eight sites that we're asking people to travel from, our distance from site to site is somewhere between 1 to just over 2 miles. And the other three sites that we're consulting on are between 2 and 3 miles. Now, I do recognise that people live in a, you know, it's like a Venn diagram. They live outside of, they don't live on the doorstep of the job centre, some people. And as we go through the consultation and the implementation activities, we'll make sure that we look at those outlying customers and think about where's the best place for them to go to. But at the moment, this is proposals, you know, so we're going through the consultation period.
I know that many members want to come in, and I may come back in again as well.
Picking up on these questions, and particularly with regard to Glasgow, I mean, I understand the issue of the 20-year contract, and I also understand that, as the all-party House of Commons Work and Pensions Committee said unanimously in a report only last month, that the future of Job Centre Plus is one of change, and to make a success of its new role, Job Centre Plus will have to ensure that it's open to working in ways that are increasingly flexible, adaptable, and experimental. I understand all of that. But given that, given those contexts, I still have three questions about the proposals with regard to Glasgow. First, am I correct in understanding that we're talking both about the merger of a number of job centres and about the closure of a number of job centres? So if I've understood the communications from the Secretary of State in the last few days correctly, it's proposed that there are to be three job centres that will close in Glasgow, and that in addition to that, there will be a number of mergers. For example, I understand that Annisland and Partick will be merged. So the first question is, am I correct about that? Second question is, you know, I understand the concerns about commercial confidentiality, but this Parliament has well-established ways in which governments can communicate with parliamentarians under conditions of strict confidence that enable us as elected representatives to understand in advance the thinking that government does. I'm a member of the Finance and Constitution Committee, and the Finance and Constitution Committee frequently takes issues in confidence where it's necessary for reasons of commercial confidentiality. So I'm sorry, but that excuse doesn't stack up given the well-established procedures that we have in this Parliament for dealing with those sorts of questions. And third, about the consultation that you just referred to, is that a consultation only about the closures, or is it also a consultation about the mergers of other job centres elsewhere in Glasgow? And is that consultation live yet? Because I couldn't find it on the DWP website this morning.
Okay, so I'll take the first one, which is there are 8 job centres that the services will propose not to be operating in those areas. I'm trying to be clear. So, you know, mergers or closures, those job centres will not have the same job centres once actually we go through consultation or unless consultation says that we should retain them. So there's 8 job centres, 5 of which are for full... I suppose what you're talking about is what is for full consultation or not. So yeah. 3 are for full consultation, and 5 are within the guidelines of what we consider to be reasonable distance to travel to a neighbouring job centre. So 5 are within that less than 3 miles or 20 minutes away. So those are our sort of guidelines that we use. Mm-hmm. So that those 5 are not for full consultation. They're with the accounting officer, and basically we can decide where to put the business, I'm afraid. 3 are for full consultation because they're outside, and so from a ministerial perspective, there are some guidelines that the ministers decided we should be thinking about, and those are over 3 miles or over 20 minutes. So 3 are for full consultation, which is Bridgeton...
Castlemilk and Maryhill.
Thank you. Yeah. Castlemilk and Maryhill. And 5 are not for full consultation. Now, that means that all services are still going to be provided in the sites wherever the customers are asked to go to. So it's not. There's no jobs lost. The individuals will still receive the service, and in fact a better service than they're getting currently, because we just can't operate out of some of those job centres in the way that we wish to. Mm-hmm. The second question was around the commerciality issue and your concern about not being advised beforehand. I'm afraid you're going to have to take that up with ministers. It's really not for me to comment on, I'm afraid, Ms. Tompkins. And thirdly, the issue of... sorry, remind me again.
Is the consultation live?
Consultation live. So at the moment, yesterday it wasn't, so I'll take that away and make sure that I understand when it will go on. We've got posters and leaflets, but, you know, you're right. When is it going to be visible to people that aren't visiting the job centre? We have issued letters to all stakeholders as well, and certainly I'll be very happy to provide the website address for this committee.
So the consultation we've been told is going to run until the 18th of January.
Yes.
So what's the length of consultation that you would ordinarily expect for such a period? I had thought that the normal length of consultation for government consultations was 12 weeks.
I've been advised by the programme that the 18th of January is the deadline.
Even though the consultation is not yet live? So that deadline won't be put back given that your delays in getting it up and running?
I will have to take that away.
Please do.
Thank you.
Polly McNeill, then
George. Yeah, so it's on the same subject. I'm not convinced that for the people of Glasgow this is a better service. I'd like to know if you're still in negotiation then with the landlords over these properties, or has that stopped? Is that the sole reason for the 3 closures and 5 mergers? And as Adam Tompkins has said, it seems extraordinary that you would, given what Sandra White has said about the volume of claimants in Glasgow and the extent of the closures, it's extraordinary that we've hardly any consultation time at all. I mean, most people will probably go on some kind of holiday from the 23rd of December, the government must be aware that it's very difficult to run a consultation period in that period where a lot of things completely shut down. So it doesn't leave much time for consultation at all. So we need to take this up in another forum, but I'd just like to get this on the record that that's just quite extraordinary, the extent of these closures. But anyway, I'd like to know if you're still in negotiation with the landlords. But also on this question about what's a reasonable distance. Now, I don't know how well you know Glasgow, but those who know Glasgow will know you can't travel north and south of the river sometimes on the same bus. Has any of this been taken into consideration at all? I mean, this will be a complaint from many claimants across the country. It's not that you're 20 minutes from the property. It's how long does it actually take you to get there if you've no car? And I'd like to think that there was some consideration given when you thought what you made a decision of what a reasonable distance was.
So again, two things. One, we used the IT systems that we've got to investigate Travelline and also Google Maps. I get that's not getting on a bus and getting off a bus.
It's not.
No, but it's still a Travelline that tells us.
Why would you not? Surely, if you were modelling, if you like, how long is it going to take a claimant on average? Surely you would look at the bus services. No.
But that's what I'm saying. What we've done is looked at Travelline, yeah, and looked at the bus services to and from and also route, yes. It's not physically doing it. So, you know, there is something here about, as we get into granular planning, understanding how customers can get to and from, and particularly from those outside of the direct link between job centre to job centre. So there's further work to do, without a doubt.
And are you still negotiating with landlords over any of these properties?
I understand that the negotiations across the UK are still going on. Where they are in specific terms with Glasgow, it's not part of my responsibilities, I'm afraid.
Before I bring George Adams, could I just ask another question, perhaps even Mr. Cooling as well? At the very beginning, we went to visit Musselburgh Job Centre, and yet these closures were imminent, and no one passed this to the committee. Yourself, Denise, had said that it wasn't within your power to let the committee know, and you only knew about it yourself. But there's been an awful lot of work went on in the background, obviously, when you say about Travelline. So obviously, Mr. Cooling and yourself, I'd assume, and others would have talked to each other. So they must have known that these job centre closures were going to happen months ago, and yet you're saying that it wasn't in your power and you were only told when it was announced. So I'd like a wee bit of clarity there in that respect, considering we're only giving people in Glasgow, as Adam Tonkins and Pauline McNeill have said, you're only giving them something like a week, really, because you've got the Christmas and New Year holiday period. Claimants are only, and others are only given a week for the consultation. And yet, how long has this been going on about the job centre closures, which no one seemingly knew about? And if I could just fling something else into the mix. The landlord in Castlemilk has said that he will reduce his costs, his rates, for the job centre there to ensure that it stays there. So once again, we're talking about renegotiation as well.
So timescales, without a doubt, you're absolutely right, convener. You know, these didn't just drop out of fresh air. Mm-hmm. You know, there was a discussion about what seemed to be acceptable and available for the City of Glasgow. What was the best use of estate? How was we going to deliver the services? But those proposals went then into a consultation period with the landlords. So those negotiations that were going on were going out somewhere else in the organisation. I didn't know the end shape of it until 5 days before, when actually I'm told that actually those negotiations are finished and the proposals were okay as such from a commercial point of view. So that's the clarity I knew 5 days before, of which I still am not in a position to be public about it until the day of announcement.
So basically the department looked at only these closures, only these areas in Glasgow?
No.
I think you need to clarify that. Was it a bigger a bigger trawl you had in Glasgow or Scotland as a whole, and you settled on the Glasgow one?
So, I mean, this is where I sort of agree with Mr. Tompkins and disagree with Mr. Tompkins at the same time. Okay, imagine this, there are 1,000 negotiations effectively going on. I mean, I'm probably exaggerating the number because some of them are with a landlord who own about 40% of our buildings. But you know, just imagine there are lots of negotiations going on different timescales, completing or not completing. So Denise's equivalent across Great Britain, some of them know what's happened in some locations and we've published those. In other locations, there are still discussions carrying on. So we don't yet have a complete national GB picture here. So what Denise is saying is absolutely right. As negotiations are completing, Denise and others will be made aware, not least because when the negotiations completed, the landlord is then free to say, because the negotiations are completed, what's going on, because many of them have commercial considerations as well, and their shareholders know they've been in negotiating with us. So it's quite a complicated picture to lay out for everybody exactly what's going on, either in the middle of those negotiations and subsequent to them, what then would happen. So it's this is why I think I agree, Mr. Tompkins, and disagree. We are talking to the Scottish Government, we are talking to MSPs and MPs about the consequences of the decisions we might make across the piece here. But it is not possible to do that in the midst of the negotiations, simply because you might find that a landlord says to you, I don't want you in our property from now on. And we've had a number of those in the negotiations too. So we've had to try and source another property in that location, or we might be coming out of that location and the landlord doesn't want us to come out of that location. And may offer us, a revised deal, even after the negotiations have happened. So, you know, I'm not trying to hide behind the argument. It's very complicated, but it is quite complicated. And I don't think you should infer a lack of a desire to talk or consult from that. It is just quite a tricky thing to do, this one. We'll never have a 20-year deal again where they all end at the same time.
I asked this question and I don't have an answer. I mean, it's a big department. It's a government department. I know it's negotiations are complicated, but I want to be clear. Is this the reason, because of the 20-year leases coming to an end, is this the sole reason why you're potentially closing 5 job centres in Glasgow? Is that what it amounts to?
I wouldn't put it like as the sole reason. It is clearly
a point in time
that we have to renegotiate. Whatever would happen, okay, at the end of this 20-year deal, we would have to renegotiate. If we'd left it to 2018, we would have been taken to the cleaners by our existing providers. But that's why we're engaged in a process now about why are you doing this now? Well, because if we can do it now and reach a deal beforehand, we will strike a better deal in terms of cost.
Yes, but essentially, notwithstanding at what point you negotiate and what point you go public,
okay.
Essentially, the reason that... sorry to dwell on this, but I just want to be clear. Sure. But essentially, the reason that we're having this consultation is because you're having to renegotiate, albeit in a complex way, these properties. There's not another reason for proposing the closures of these job centres other than that.
I think the end of... Sorry, can
go
I come
on.
In?
I haven't heard one.
So the contract coming to an end gives us an opportunity of looking at the estate completely across the whole of Scotland and making best use of what we've got. So, you know, I've got half-empty buildings that actually we've been paying for, as well as buildings that I can't fit all
in
services
Glasgow.
In. Yeah. So the whole point about bringing the hubs together was to maximise the use in the buildings where we've got space so that we can provide better services. And we are currently in those sites where we're closing because actually we can't fit the services in. And certainly with the footfall under UC, it would worry me if I retained some of that accommodation.
I mean, the 20-year deal effectively locked us into a lot of properties as well. So Denise has been left with great sort of underutilized space in a lot of places, and we've been unable to get out of that because if we wanted to leave that's a building, we had to pay a premium price to get out. So that's why I say I'm struggling a bit, Ms. McNeill, in answering your question, because it's an opportunity. But if I say an opportunity, you'll think I'm sort of, you know, I've been wanting to close sites and do stuff for a long time. That's not the case. We're trying to shape our business for the future. If you want, you know, universal credit, we'll, in this phase, put about another million people through the kind of job centre network. So Denise, when she constructs her plans for Scotland, needs to size for that fact. And even after doing that in Glasgow, you come to the conclusion that we have come to in terms of the shape of the job centre network there. So that's really what we're trying to focus on.
Did you want to go in a small one, Mark, before the same point, and then
Jordan? Just very patient. Just to clarify, if I've picked you up correctly or not, you said that you're in a process of renegotiating across the whole of the UK, and you've completed that in Glasgow, and that's why you've been able to bring forward these proposals. So can I just clarify if we're going to see similar proposals then coming forward in Lanarkshire, Falkirk, Lothians, and right across Scotland for similar proposed closures?
Right, so there's two things. One, we've already made some closures. So Stornoway is moving into the debt centre. I think I mentioned this at Musselburgh, actually. And Gala, for example, we're closing the building there and moving into a smaller accommodation because that's all that we need there. It's a reverse. Concerning the rest of Scotland, yes, it's not been concluded. Now, I'd love to sit here and say I can assure you about the rest of the sites in Scotland, but I can't as of today. We will know, hopefully, by the end of sort of February or March at the latest, where we are with every single site across the UK. But I don't know. I can't tell you today.
I want to come in that quick one, and I know you've been very patient, George, because it's a different subject. Alice, you don't. Gordon Lintott, do you want? And then George Adams.
Thank you, convener. I understand what you're saying about the need to reassess your sites and what you're doing and so forth. And because leases come to an end, there appears to, from what you say, have been a block deal, that it gives you an opportunity to do that now. But if you're having a consultation and it's in such a short time scale, as has been pointed out, does that not mean that people will suspect and, in fact, might it not be true that the consultation is pointless? It's simply one of these consultations that's being held after the event. What is the purpose of the consultation?
I think for the three sites it's to listen for me. So, you know, we've already said that the timescale appears to be too short. So, you know, I'll take that away, but I can't promise today because these consultation periods are set somewhere else.
So does that mean the approach to be adopted or the decision that will be made in terms of the sites may be altered as a result of the consultation?
Why consult, if not?
We have to be open to the possibility that you would change. I used to run the Job Centre Network and ran a number of consultations on a number of buildings across Great Britain and changed our thinking on a number of those. In the light of local feedback. So, yes, it's an open consultation.
Thank you.
I think the committee here is all in agreement that you do take back the fact that the committee is very concerned that the consultation period is actually just about a week, and we would certainly wish that it would be taken back, that it be longer to whoever you take it back to. It would be interesting to know who it is, actually. Maybe we'll find that out eventually. George Adams.
Perhaps could convene if I can just say I sit on the executive team of the Department for Work and Pensions,
great.
So I've heard the message very clearly.
Thank you very much. George Adams.
Thank you, convener. I think the fact it's a week, and as Polly McNeill said, it's over Christmas as well. You know, it's not exactly the best timing, or you could be cynical and say it was perfectly timed. But I would like to talk about the universal credit rollout itself. Mr. Cooling, you've said we've seen it in action, and unfortunately we have. We have seen it in its various guises in our constituencies. I've had tragic stories come into my constituency office. The human carnage created by the sanctions regime, as an example, is just causing untold kind of problems with families throughout the, and it was also evidence that we brought from Musselburgh CAB as well. Could you tell me, so that we can actually go through it, what is the process for sanctions regime in general? Because we seem to have all kinds of different stories, and 9 times out of 10, by the time an MSP or a parliamentarian gets involved, we can sort it out. But why do we get to that stage, and why do we end up causing all that problem?
Okay, it is a slightly different process for sanctions within Universal Credit compared to Job Seekers Allowance. And if you allow me a little bit of explanation, it may help the understanding here. In Job Seekers Allowance, if you fail to attend, if you do not turn up and sign on in old language, we stop your money. We wait about 5 to 6 days to see if you contact us, but we stop the case there, and we stop paying you. In Universal Credit, we don't do that, because Universal Credit is not just the kind of Job Seekers Allowance portion of entitlement. You've got housing, you may have money for children, maybe some money for disability or caring in that total. So we don't stop the money if you don't contact us. What we do is we refer for a sanction in that case only on the Job Seeker Allowance equivalent bit of that entitlement. That's for two reasons. One, I mentioned test and learning early on. Early on in the rollout, we realised we were in danger of people who went into work and just failed to tell us. Quite often people don't tell us when they go into work. We would be withdrawing a big chunk of support when they would qualify for continuing Universal Credit in work. So in the experience that you will see, I think, and probably, you know, the cases that go wrong come to you and your constituencies in your constituency offices, because the cases that go right will never go anywhere near you. You will see a bit more noise around sanctions, but it's not about a desire to be punitive. It's actually the opposite of trying not to do what we would do under the old system, which would switch everything off, because there's so much money now riding on the Universal Credit claim. It's not just that Job Seekers Allowance amount. So I don't know if that helps you understand just kind of what's going on there. Because when you see the numbers, it will be very easy to go, crikey, there are a lot more people being sanctioned under Universal Credit than there were under Job Seekers Allowance. But that will be because under Job Seekers Allowance, it wouldn't show up as a sanction, it would show up as a closed claim, and we're not closing people's claims.
But that still doesn't sort the problem that the person's not getting the money that they need at that time as well. You know, that's the human cost of the whole policy as well. And I'm quite sure that some of the noise, as you put it, that we're hearing about it, you said that you want to concentrate on what's working with the system, as opposed to the noise surrounding what's not working. But the problem is, using your words again, the noise and things that are not working is actually what the public are talking about. That is the important thing, and that's the bit that's affecting people's lives. Because at the end of the day, you are these people's last best hope to actually sort things out. And if it's not there, if that safety net's not there, it becomes very difficult for these individuals.
So I think that's to misconstrue what I was saying in my opening comments. What I was saying was that, and I've read the evidence that previous witnesses have given to the committee, and that was solely focused on what was going wrong. What I was trying to give the committee was a short 5-minute version of what's going right as well. I'm very happy to focus on what's been going wrong, to talk about that, and to talk about how we've been trying to improve things.
But you misunderstand me if you think I'm not going
to focus on what's going wrong. That is not what I said.
In any walk of life, in order to improve our system, you have to work out what's going wrong and fix it. I'm saying we just can't sit there with kind of rose-tinted glasses and say these are the good things that are happening with the system. We have to deal with the issues, and in particular because of the people we're dealing with, in your case, we have to get this right. And it's very flippant to just say the noise surrounding this. This is people's lives we're dealing with, Mr. Cooling here. You know, this is extremely important. I'm sure you're aware of that.
I'm not being flippant. And I think we're talking a bit past each other here. I think we're actually having an agreement. But in order to understand what is going on, I think it's better to see the whole picture and not just part of the picture. Now, you may disagree with me on that, and that's your right. But I think we should look at the whole picture.
The timescales, some of the Citizens Advice Bureau from Musselburgh mentioned about the timescales being a major issue, the lack of flexibility, the fact that it's an online system, it's there's no flexibility for the individuals, and at the end up it's a 4 to 6 week period, and as you've already said, some of that includes housing benefit money, so it builds up more arrears. We've had witnesses saying that in councils that it's building up more arrears for housing as well. You know, how are you going to address that? Because one of the things that we've actually heard was that some of your pilot schemes down south that you've had, you've actually had these issues and you didn't fix them then, and you just transferred them to Musselburgh and the other sites as well. So how are you actually going to deal with that if you're not actually solving the problems?
So the picture on arrears is an interesting one, and how it's presented is interesting too. If I start with just what's the headline position on arrears, based on what the data and search we've done, is that about 48% of universal credit claimants are in some form of arrears with their kind of housing payment. After 3 months, that's fallen to 33%. Okay, so there's an issue at the start of the claim. And you know, I know the committee's heard evidence about the six-week period before you're paid and so forth. But there's also something here about landlord attitude. And there's something about just our experience about how claimants are finding it interacting with the system. 2 points here. The first point about landlord attitude is that we found a number of landlords charge rent in advance when we, in the benefit system, pay in arrears, and in fact, employers pay in arrears as well. I'm sure your salaries here for the Scottish Parliament are not paid in advance, they're paid in arrears. So there's a bit of a book arrears problem here in some of the presentation. It's also the case that a number of people are entering universal credit already with arrears. Now, I'm not, just so we don't go past each other again, Mr. Adam, denying that the amount of arrears on individual cases has grown. But it's not right to suggest, and you weren't, so I'm not accusing you of this, that universal credit is the causal factor in somebody having arrears. Very many people have arrears when they come into universal credit, and we're building a bit at the start of that, partly because of the way in which the system has been designed by Parliament, and then we are actually starting to clear those arrears. Now, why is that happening? There's another kind of causal factor here as well that we identified in the while we're keeping it small and we are trying to address this, which is many people, particularly in the social rented sector, do not understand that they have a rent liability. So, and I'm not blaming them, this is just how the previous system was kind of constructed, but people are coming to us declaring on their claims that they don't pay rent. And then about 2 months later, we're getting an anguished call from a social landlord saying they haven't paid their rent for 2 months, what's going on? Now, they, in good faith, said, well, I don't pay rent because it's been taken care of by housing benefit for years and years and years. So we have done some work, and I was in East Lothian talking to Angela Leach about this a few months ago, about when we bring people onto universal credit, how do we explain to them that they are liable for their rent if they've got rent? And if they're living in a social rented sector property, they have got rent, they just might not appreciate they've got rent. So we've got issues like that to work with. And what we've been saying to East Lothian is join us in the kind of group sessions we have for claimants at the start of their claim, when we explain to them what universal credit is like, what they've got to do to help them in their declaration that they've got a rent liability here. So there's a number of factors driving this. It's the attitude of lawyers, the attitude of landlords, in terms of how they book arrears in their own accounts. There's the pre-existing arrears position. There's the interactions of the six-week kind of process before you get your first payment. And there's a lack of understanding about universal credit and what it is you need to declare at the start of your claim. And yes, to your, you know, last question to me, the previous question to me, we are working on this, trying to improve the situation here.
George, did you want to come in again?
I was just going to ask one very short, simple question.
And then Mark Griffin, you want to come in the back of that?
There appears to be... Do you target staff for sanctions? Because there seems to be a myth or an urban myth that staff are actually encouraged to do more sanctions.
Yeah, so no, we don't. I did a study for the then Secretary of State in 2014, I think, that we published that debunked that myth. It persists inside of the organisation. Denise, I know, will do lots of work in her team with her managers to continually emphasise to people that we do not have a target for sanctions.
Okay. Mark, do you want to come in particularly on that then? It's Alison.
Yep, thanks, Convener. I wanted to touch on the issue of universal credit and rent arrears as well.
Yeah.
But firstly, just to ask, the previous benefit, housing benefit, was that paid in arrears or in advance?
It's paid in arrears.
So I don't understand then why universal credit should be different when housing benefit was paid in arrears, that any change and move to universal credit and the housing element of that being paid in arrears should make any difference. But some of the evidence that we have here, local authorities, Highland Council, 82% of council tenants claiming universal credit in a live service area, 96% of tenants in digital service in rent arrears last month. East Lothian, 82% in arrears. Inverclyde, 69% of universal credit claim in arrears. From my time in local government, those seem to be staggeringly high numbers of people who are in arrears. How is that? How are those figures in comparison to other areas?
So, I mean, I think it's in terms of other areas. What we've yet been unable to do is to try and isolate the UC effect, if I can describe it like that, on arrears, because in the old housing benefit world, for social landlords who happen to be councils, which I know in Scotland is predominantly the case, the kind of risk was kind of contained. So if you were in arrears because, as I said, housing benefit was paid in arrears, whether you actually booked those arrears or not, or even noticed them as a council, because you knew the way that housing benefit worked, eventually the rent was going to get cleared, so you weren't particularly worried about that. As the universal credit moves that outside of your boundary, you're super sensitised to that, I think. So the thing I think that's kind of shocked landlords, particularly social landlords, is that when they've looked at their own kind of accounts and realised now, and this is true in a number of the, as Mr. Adams said, a number of the pilot areas down south, they've actually been quite shocked at the level of arrears that they were carrying inside of the system. So we are trying to do a piece of work to isolate the universal credit effect here, because if there are things that we can do to minimise this, this is in everybody's interest to do that. But as yet, this is quite a tricky piece of analysis to do, because our kind of base analysis, the pre-existing situation, the information's not very clear across, you know, all of the councils and all of the social landlords and so forth. So we have, I think we do have an issue, I'm not denying it, about a higher level of arrears, but they are not, you know, this is not out of control, as it were. It's a higher level of arrears that, because of the way universal credit then works, the arrears get cleared actually quite quickly, which is why in my opening comment, I can't remember to which question it was now, I said, you know, 48% in arrears in at the start of the claim by after 3 months is down to 33%, and it's falling after that as well. So we're clearing the arrears, as it were, out of the system. So it's a short-term effect for landlords. Does that make any sense to you?
Thank you.
Gordon Lindhurst, you want to come in? A small question, that then it's Alison Johnson.
I think it's actually just been answered. Thank you, convener. Oh,
thank you very much. Alison Johnson.
Thank you very much. I'd probably like to pursue the arrears point. East Lothian Council will be discussing a report, an update on welfare reform and universal credit at their meeting on the 20th of December. The report's by the Deputy Chief Executive, Resource and People Services, and I have to say it makes very concerning reading. It speaks about the impact of universal credit full service on mainstream council house rent collection. And it tells us that current rent, tenant rent arrears have increased by almost 20%. That's an increase of £241,000+ by way of comparison. During the same period in the previous year, tenant rent arrears reduced by some 51,000.
Yeah.
So there are serious concerns raised by themselves and indeed by the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations, who said that at a joint SFHA-DWP meeting in September, you pledged that you wouldn't allow the further rollout of universal credit in Scotland until it was safe to do so. Now, we've heard previously from witnesses involved in the rollout in East Lothian, and I think there are some very serious concerns. So I'd be grateful if you could let us know what you're doing to reassure councils like East Lothian that this is going to be addressed. I mean, you said because of the way it's collected, sometimes the arrears could be cleared off quickly. I hope that's certainly the case. I'd also be grateful if you could touch upon the impact that the loss of implied consent is having on a great number of people. I think the SFHA feel that because people can't advocate, you know, welfare rights charities can't advocate on behalf of people in the way they might have, this is leading to unnecessary evictions. So if you could focus on those 2 points first, I'd be grateful.
Okay. Don't let me forget implied consent, but I'm sure you won't. But let me concentrate first on the arrears position, particularly in East Lothian, who have, as I said, I went and met with East Lothian Council because of the situation to explain what had been going on. And there's been another exacerbating factor at this point in the rollout that I need to tell the committee about, so if I may. So we are keeping the rollout small. That's no comfort if you're in East Lothian, because it doesn't matter, because if you're in East Lothian, the rollout's big, because it's happening in your kind of locality. So that doesn't wash as an argument with Angela Leach and her colleagues, and I wouldn't try that with them anyway. But one of the things that happened in the process, which did cause me, and I have paused the rollout before, I mean, nobody noticed when I did, but I paused the rollout back in March, despite me putting it on gov.uk and everybody had done this. And it's quite amazing for Universal Credit that nobody actually rounded on me and told me this was the end of Universal Credit because I paused the rollout. I mean what I say. If it looks unsafe, if we can't be confident that we can deliver services to our customers, we won't go ahead with Universal Credit until we are confident. So I have a track record of pausing it. I'll do it again if we need to. I didn't in the autumn, even though we knew we had some problems, okay? And I took the judgment that these were containable and recoverable. But what was going on was we weren't making enough determinations at the end of that first assessment period, which was creating a kind of vicious circle in terms of the way in which work was processed back in our service centres. Essentially what happens, if you get behind, you get more calls, you then get further behind and you get yourself into a bit of a nasty circle about all of that. And we had to break our way out of that. We broke our way out of that by, I deployed extra resources into the service centres. I've basically gone 25% above what my kind of staffing allocation would be to put those resources in. I can do that because I kept that small. And what that's allowed us to do is to fight our way out of the sort of rather vicious circle we were in there. So what you've seen happen now is that we're now up to making, you know, my kind of personal estimate of the management information I see is about 9 out of 10 cases with housing payments are now being made in that first, at the end of that first, by the end of that 6-week period of the initial claim, which should have the effect of not creating the kind of very high levels of arrears that East Lothian experienced, because when we were rolling out in East Lothian, we were nowhere near 90%. At our lowest point, we were at about 50% at one point in this cycle when I was talking to them about it. Now, it takes a little bit of a time to recover, and our telephone service is the last thing that is recovering on that journey, because as we've cleared the arrears and got their claims up to date, then the number of phone calls you get starts to fall, and the call wait times improve, and then you're into a virtuous circle of delivery rather than that vicious circle we were in before. So that's driven in the Musselburgh example and for East Lothian a rather difficult set of circumstances. And I've said to them that, you know, ultimately, if there are costs accruing to you for this, you know, I'm open to having a discussion about what the department can do about that, because, you know, we asked them to go first in this. As I said, it is a learning, test and learn environment. And if there are stuff that's hit them as a consequence of that, I don't think they should suffer that because of us. Mm-hmm. So we're in some discussions about that without making them promises or making a promise here. I've said we'll look at some of that. So that's what's happened there. And you know, I'm pleased to say in November, 9 out of 10, I think, cases being paid in the first assessment period, which is actually better than housing benefit kind of performance, because there'll always be some cases who've got queries on that you can't do at that kind of pace, but that's there.
Mm-hmm. Bring Alison. Did you want to come back in on that?
Yeah, I'm coming on that one, and then I'll do implied consent. I promise.
Yeah, well, I'm quite happy to move on to implied consent. I mean, I think implied consent has an impact on arrears in the long run. If people are unable to understand what's happening and they need, you know, a bit of assistance, let's face it, I think that the system is fairly complex.
Yeah.
You know, why did we get to a position that implied consent didn't follow the change to full service?
So we have implied consent in live service. We do not have it in full service. Okay. And if I just explain why and then what you can do and how you can get explicit consent and not implied consent, if this is not too a detailed description for you. And I'm happy to do a note to the committee afterwards if it helps. It's quite a complicated story. We don't have implied consent because the claimant has full access to all the information we hold on them. So if you went into Citizens Advice Scotland office, say, and said, I'm having a problem with my universal credit claim, if you go on one of their systems, you can see the advisor can see the whole claim. They can see everything the assessor has at their end of, you know, at the DWP end. Okay, why is it like that? Because we have a principle that the data that we hold is actually the claimant's data. It's not ours, and they should be able to see everything we've said on the case, everything, all the discussions that go on between us via the journal, via the to-dos and so forth. And some of you have been to Musselburgh may have seen some of this.
Was that the case with Live?
No, it's not the case with Live. In Live, you can't do that. There's no, you can't see your system account. So we have implied consent, so your advisor can ring up on your behalf and go and ask queries. Now, it doesn't mean the advisor can't then ring up, okay? And if the claimant would like the advisor to speak for them, there's a very simple thing they need to do, which is put in the journal, I would like my advisor, Neil Cooling, to speak to you about this. And we will then speak to that advisor about them. We may check back that you're in the room with the person, or if you're not in the room, we'll set up a three-way telephone call. If you're, say, you're in a rural community and you've rung Citizens Advice Scotland and you want them to ring us, and we'll set up a three-way call to do that for you. So it's not that we don't have, well, we don't have implied consent, but what we haven't done, which is what I've sort of said to my team we must do, is explain to the advice world how they work in the new system. We've not withdrawn anybody's rights to do stuff.
I think that would be very helpful, because Citizens Advice, the SFHA, are very concerned about this. Yeah, so perhaps we need more dialogue. Convener, yeah. Can I ask
it's
one?
It's a small one then.
Uh-huh. Okay. We were speaking earlier about sanctions, and I suppose the universal credit combines both in and out of work benefits. Yeah. So I think this in-work conditionality is very much a new requirement, and perhaps one that a lot of people don't understand. And the Institute for Fiscal Studies estimates that 1.3 million universal credit claimants who are in work will be faced with conditionality, which is a doubling of those who could be faced with conditionality at the moment. I mean, do you think there's enough support on offer in job centres and so on to help people understand that?
Not yet, and that's not what we're doing yet, which is probably one of the biggest misunderstandings we've currently got out there about in work. You know, ultimately, on universal credit, there'll be about 7 million households on universal credit by the time which we've rolled out, and about 3 million of those will be in work. But some of them will be working at what we call, we have kind of thresholds in the scheme for, you know, effectively working full-time, just have may have, I don't know, quite high housing costs, a couple of children, and qualify for support, and we won't have very much to do with them other than administer their claim. But there's a bunch of people who are working a bit, who we'd like to work a bit more, see if they could earn a bit more, and that's who we want to work with and help. But nobody in the world has tried to do this before. There's a slight, I think there's one canton in Switzerland who tried something once, and there's just no evidence for this. So what we have done, using the people flowing on to the live service from a point in time, I think it was September this year, is we're running a randomised control trial on those people. So people who are on universal credit who get a job, and they're either directed to no help group, so they're effectively the control, or we're trying out with the people directed others various forms and different forms of support. Okay, but that is just a trial. We have no resources yet to roll that out across the country. It's not in my plan, and as I sort of told the PAC a while ago, if somebody changes my plan from outside, i.e. Parliament wants more things done, different things done, then I will reserve the right to change my, you know, the plan that I'm working to accommodate some of that stuff. So we are trialling this. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows what will work. So we're trying out a number of different interventions here. It's not about applying sanctions, and you know, it's not that kind of crude. It's been a bit kind of misrepresented like that. It's about trying to understand what would help people progress on and upwards. And then when I get the results of that randomised control trial, if it shows what interventions work, then, you know, I'll put some proposals to ministers, ultimately to the Treasury, to fund any kind of activity or whatever it is we need to do. I think there's your sister committee in Westminster, mm-hmm, have done quite a good report on this, where they initially started, hey, you're about sanctioning people again, DWP, and we worked quite hard with them to understand what they were doing, and it's almost unheard of for a select committee to commend us, but we actually got commended for the work we're doing on this. Mm-hmm. So I'm determined that we're led by the evidence here, and you know, the state of the public finances are such, I don't think we could be led any other way.
Thank you. Ben McPherson, then Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a number of questions, but first of all, I just wanted to say good morning, and that it was great to visit the job centre in Musselburgh a number of weeks ago, and I think I speak for all of us on the committee just to how much we respect the hard job that frontline staff are doing in job centres, not just in Musselburgh, but across Scotland and indeed the UK.
Thank you.
One thing that happened at that visit was that we had a real interesting first-hand insight into the process of how universal credit is managed on the ground, so to speak, on the floor of job centres across the country, and how pertinent and important the claimant commitment is to this whole system, and how fundamental it is in both setting the expectation and the standards, and how much of a repercussion it can have potentially if the claimant commitment isn't fulfilled in terms of sanctions and other and the punitive measures that can follow thereafter. So I just want to drill down into some of the detail of that, and first of all, ask how work coaches are trained to set appropriate work-related requirements for claimants, whether that's covered by a medical certificate or awaiting a work capability assessment. And also, separately but interrelated, you know, what is the process of guidance and training around the discretion that's involved in that process, and the monitoring, the constant reassessment that needs to happen in order to make sure that that is a healthy process in terms of encouragement and bringing people on to fulfil the work commitments that are set.
Firstly, thanks a lot for the message. I will take that back to the teams on frontline because it means an awful lot. They see so much in the papers, so thank you very much. Right, so training. When we get a new work coach, they go on a routeway of training, which takes them through both technical and also what's called solution-focused training. And the solution-focused training is the bit that I think you're interested in, which is it's how they interact with an individual, how they draw the individual out, how they actually work with the individual to identify what their own solutions are rather than being told. In the dim and distant past, you know, we would have been sat there advising people. You know, it wasn't by default that we changed the term that we called our people, you know, advising people of what they had to do rather than actually working with them to try and draw out what they can do. Firstly, and then secondly, what support they need to progress towards employment or into employment. So that's the training. We're also now picking up accreditation. So through City and Guilds, we've picked that routeway up. We've pushed it through the City and Guilds accreditation process, make sure it's robust. And we've got some trials at the moment with our new work coaches about how to apply the City and Guilds standard to that routeway. So I think that's the training. The continuous improvement, what I've got at the moment is I'm changing the organisation in the job centres so that we declutter the line managers of our work coaches. That all of the extraneous activity that they've been doing that is important is given to somebody who's got those responsibilities solely, which allows them hopefully to spend around about 80% of their time coaching their work coaches. And they'll have around about, depending upon, you know, the numbers of part-timers I've got, anywhere between 9 and probably 13 work coaches to look after. And their role will be primarily to make sure that the services that they're providing, the information that's coming back from customers, and the services that we wrap around the work coaches is really appropriate. So that's probably all I need to say at this stage.
Sure. I mean, I think obviously every situation is different because every person's different. But I think for transparency, it would be useful. I certainly think as a politician, it'd be useful for greater transparency around how discretion is managed and how the process around making sure that these work capable, claimant commitments are appropriate for every individual. It would be beneficial, in fact, highly pertinent in my view.
Yeah.
And I would like to just be absolutely clear. You know, what happens if a claimant commitment isn't accepted by the individual involved, and what would be your approach if, in terms of whether the presence of an advocate or an advisor at the initial meeting and setting up a claimant commitment could or should be encouraged? Mm.
So there's a couple of things. I'll end up with saying the other thing that we do is we do formal quality assurance meetings with every work coach. So they must be quality assured by their line manager once a month as a minimum. Now I want more than that. You know, that's why I'm reorganising, to make sure that the majority of a work coach team leader's time is with their work coaches, because observations, you know, in all different guises is really helpful in this space to improve both performance, but also, you know, the individual's capability for somebody to observe whether those capability needs are being met, whether they need to go further training, or whether we've got a gap in the wraparound services, as I said before. So there is a formal, it's not just about nice and squidgy observing, it's really very much about some quality assurance activity as well. Isn't accepted, if a claimant commitment isn't accepted, the expectation would be that the customer is seen by the line manager as to why the customer felt that the claimant commitment couldn't be accepted. I don't actually know what those statistics are. I think they are so few and far between. My concern is the other way, that people sign things when they're not quite clear about it, which is why, again, I'm really keen and making sure that people are, our work coach team leaders are very clear about what those relationships are with the customer, and their work coaches are supported.
I mean, is there pressure put on claimants to accept the...
No, not in that way. I mean, there, it's explained what it is. It's explained that actually the commitment is will be a discussion between the individual. They will have to provide some evidence. Normally, people are quite happy. The question for me is when people feel as though they've walked out of the building and then think maybe actually they've agreed to too much. Yeah, that shouldn't happen, yeah, but maybe it does sometimes. The issue is they should come back, and I see... meetings time again when I sit in where work coaches say, if you walk out of the room and you think actually this isn't achievable, then please come back and talk to me about it. We can change it.
Sorry, Ms. McPherson. There's one thing I could add. I won't run through the numbers now because you'll get very bored, I suspect. But we have actually published data on people's understanding within Universal Credit of things like the claimant commitment. Will things be followed up? What are my responsibilities? Do I understand them? And that points to us of areas where we need to improve. But we're getting quite high levels of understanding around what's going on in and around the claimant commitment. But I'll let the committee have that data rather than run through it now.
And similarly, would you be open to providing us with more details on the guidance and the way that these assessments are made on the shop floor, so to speak, just so that we can get more of an understanding as where the signposts are when claimant commitments are being assessed, are being constructed rather, and then being assessed thereafter, or are those internal documents which cannot be?
I'm not sure. Is it the claimant commitment or the quality assurance of the?
Well, both. How your staff members on the floor, so to speak, go through the process of constructing a claimant commitment.
Yes.
What is their guidance?
Yes.
And I think I would certainly be interested to know what that guidance was. Yeah. And
can we take that away? I'll see if I can provide you an answer that I think, because I think you're asking for three things, for one thing that's within three things in our mind that we're going to try and answer. We look a bit evasive. Let me, because I'm with you.
I would be grateful for
that. I'm with you. I don't see why you shouldn't be able to see how we're training our people and doing stuff.
Absolutely.
And just very quickly, similarly, convener, one of the clear ambitions that was articulated to us at Musselburgh from the work coaches was the ABC mantra, you know, any job, better job, career. And, you know, I think we can all agree that that would be advantageous if that's followed through. However, some of the third sector organisations working in this field have expressed concerns that it's an any job, no job, any job, no job pattern that a lot of individuals fall into. And I wondered if there was any data available in terms of continuous referrals, so to speak, where claimants are taking any job and then coming back,
So there is for job seekers allowance. And one of the reasons, in terms of Ms. Johnson's question, we are looking at the, and we're doing the RCT for InWork, is exactly that problem in the British system at the moment. So you've got quite a lot of people are cycling around the system. Funny enough, that's why you've got quite a lot of arrears on housing benefit as well, because you're moving in and out of having responsibility for housing benefit or paying your own rent or not when you go into work. So it is a it is an issue inside the system, which is we're attempting to do. But we've got data on job seekers allowance. I don't think we've got it yet on universal credit. But
when that data is available, would you?
Yeah, but shall I send you the job seekers allowance stuff? Because
please,
you know, it's worth a read and understanding that. Mm.
Thank you.
That would be great. Thank you.
Sorry, there was a final question. Yep. So this was about advocates. Absolutely. Yeah. Not a problem at all. And in fact, as an example in Dundee, they've actually got welfare rights sat inside the office all week, and they're there for people to actually bring into the interviews if they need them.
That's very welcoming. Given that openness and indeed enthusiasm for that, do you think there's more work that can be done between the DWP and advice organisations to try and bring more of that advice into the process?
I mean, most of my sites or districts will have their local relationships with their local advocates anyway, so Assistance Advice Bureau or you know, Welfare Rights. So, you know, they've already got those relationships. There is nothing stopping those conversations going on. Because what we want is we want people who are building relationships on a personal level, mm-hmm. but actually who feel confident to disclose their circumstances. Because without disclosing the circumstances, we really can't move the individuals on. We can't support them properly. So anything that will enable that is of benefit to us all.
Well, I think that collaborative approach is welcome. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for being here. The evidence that we've taken previously on universal credit, there's been consensus, really, that although in principle universal credit was meant to simplify things, actually in reality it's been quite complex and there's been a number of issues. You've used the phrase test and learn quite a few times, which I think is a sensible approach. But the evidence we took from some of the local authority officers was that learning actually wasn't being shared between areas. I'd just be interested to hear your comments on that.
Okay, well, I did read what the other witnesses said about not what we promised on the tin, as it were. And in fact, I once had a Twitter exchange in Welsh, which was a brave act on my part. My wife is Welsh, so I had some help at Google Translate from an advice worker who was talking about this is much more complicated than job seekers allowance. Well, it is, because it's got housing in it, it's got child inequivalent, effectively child tax credits in it, it's got some of the disability benefits in it too. So the process, if you just think of it, well, I deal with housing benefit or I deal with job seekers allowance, will look more complicated. But if you added all of those up, you will see it is simplified. The legislation is simplified, the rules around it, there's a common set of rules now, so you don't get the kind of rub effects of the housing benefit rules rubbing against the tax credit rules. And, so it is simplified in that regard. In terms of your question about the actual learning, how do we do that? This is something extraordinarily important to us. We are passionate about test and learn. It is the way to do things. We commended it to other departments and other entities like the Scottish Government, who are about to embark on running some bits of Social Security too. And, you know, it's a sort of two-way process in that we put practitioners inside of our teams developing things. So we have operations folk, we have people from the local authorities, we have claimants testing the stuff that we're building. And then when we put it out there and deploy, we have what we call the SIL process, that's CIL for the people trying to take a note of these proceedings, continuous improvement and learning. And that feeds back things from Denise's folk into my design teams, who then look at what's going on and we say, that's not meant to be happening. How do we fix that problem? Now, we've got lots of feedback that's come back. We have not acted on every piece of feedback yet because, as I said, this is a rather big enterprise we're engaged on doing. But we will get to all of this stuff and work our way through and iron out the problems. So it's two-way. We've got people doing the design who are experienced practitioners, experienced within the existing system, and then we are getting feedback from people from outside and so forth, and we're putting that back into how we polish and design the system.
Thanks for that answer. I was actually quite struck by the strength of the response from these local authority officers. I mean, these are, you know, established professionals who are well used to, you know, systemic changes and working in new ways. Your answer didn't really give me what I asked. I asked.
Let me try again.
That what they wanted was for that some of the learning that was happening with amongst the different areas to actually be shared, because obviously when we talk about things going wrong, you know, although we're talking about systems here, there are people at the end of it, and it causes real problems. So why isn't the learning being shared between the local authorities and yourselves?
Okay, so from my perspective it is, but it may not be visible to some people yet, because we've taken something back into design to get right. So for example, at the moment the local authorities are consistently saying to me, you need to share information on the benefit cap for universal credit, because in the old world, the local authorities had the information on the benefit cap because they were the ones doing the capping through housing benefit. For universal credit people, we do the capping, and what the local authorities are saying is, quite rightly, we need to know who is being capped, because that has consequences for our services and how we support people. So they're absolutely right. So I have heard that piece of feedback. What I do not have is a sort of a light switch approach where I can immediately flick something on in the system and put that information back out to them. I need to go away, design a way of providing information to them that's congruent with the data protection laws and our other responsibilities to protect the system itself in terms of the gateway that I give to them. So it's not easy to immediately respond to feedback, and I can understand why councils would be saying, well, you know, I was talking to Hounslow the other day and Hounslow said this to me. I was talking to Islington are saying this to me. You know, a number of councils are giving us this feedback. You say, well, you're not joining us up, you're not listening. We are listening. It just, my speed of response is as fast as I can, but, you know, cannot be immediate. And I think you might be picking up a bit on that, because we certainly are trying to use this feedback we're getting to improve the system and meet people's needs. Because I agree with them, we need to provide them information on the benefit cap. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Could I just come in on that particular point when you're talking about the information, because it came on board. Would that be manually or would that be computer operated? I mean, obviously with the 15% of the powers coming to the Scottish Parliament for Social Security, we're looking at obviously computer systems and extrapolating, you know, Scottish addresses and names, etc., from the bigger system, from the DWP. Would it be done in that particular way in regard to what Ruth Maguire was saying about, you know, the capping and how local authorities dealt with it previously?
So
it seems very cumbersome if it's...
Yeah,
if it's
so
not.
So I already... you've got to do it by system approach here. The volumes are such, you know, 7 million people. Can you imagine trying to do 7 million clerical bits of information at the speed of interaction between us and the local authorities or landlords or so forth. So I already provide to the councils certain bits of information, normally around so that they can operate the council tax rebate schemes that they run. So I provide things like name, NINO, address, the date universal credit started, if they're on an alternative payment arrangement for landlord, some things like that. I'm not providing at the moment benefit cap. But one of the things we're looking at is developing what we've called a landlord portal, which will allow social landlords access into the system to in pursuit of the kind of, as Ms. Johnson was saying, you know, it's a bit advocacy, but also a bit, you know, how do I, Mr. Griffin's point, you know, keep arrears down to as low as kind of possible in terms of rent and the like. Now, that's a non-trivial task to do because, as I said, there's a bit of a treasure trove of data behind the wall that is the DWP in terms of holding that data. So I've got to work out a way of doing that safely so that you can't data mine or somebody else couldn't hijack an account and get in and steal data from us. But that's what we're working on, and that's our intent.
Do you have a
time to respond to this?
Do you have a timescale for that? Because it seems very, very cumbersome and not maybe so much complicated, considering obviously local councils had this information previously. So, is there a timescale for this?
Yeah. I'm wary of giving any politician a promise because they always disappointed.
You don't need to promise.
When
give us an idea. It's not too
but,
bad.
You know, we are quite so at the conference we were talking with Scottish Federation of Housing Associations in September. We were talking about this. We've made progress in the design. The way in which we design things is in a very agile, iterative way. So we have a working prototype inside of things, but it's got to do a number of things, past security testing and so forth. So I don't have a date for you today where I think we will have done this. But I think it's one of the things I need, if this helps, before we go to scale in October 17. If I haven't got it, I'll need another way of responding to councils and landlord feedback. Yeah. So those are the sorts of timescales I'm working to. But please don't make me offer a promise here because, you know, this programme was weighed down with too many promises early on, I think, and you know, it's been successful because I've sort of avoided giving too many since then.
All we want is transparency.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. It's a very fair question.
Paula McLean wants to come in.
Yeah, it's a specific question that the SFHA raised with the committee. I'd like to ask you. It's in relation to one of the perceived benefits of universal credit is that it could be left open for 6 months after a claimant had found work. Which is obviously a benefit to people on 0 hours contract or seasonal work. So the question is, why is the practice of keeping universal credit claims live for 6 months discontinued in full service without prior consultation?
Yeah, so it's not been discontinued, we just have a different way of doing it. Mm. Okay, so technically in one sense, you could argue the claim is open for 14 months in the full service offering. All we actually do is ask you, if you come back to us, to effectively click a button that says reclaim, none of my data has changed, and we stand the claim back up, rather than in the live service where we say we keep the claim open for you for 6 months if you come back to us. You actually have to go through the claiming process again. So actually it's a better service, I think. But what we've singularly failed to do with this, with the SFHA and a number of others, is explain this to them so they understand it. Now, you know, in my own defence, we've been quite busy building this thing. It is, as I said, it is a rather big task. And explaining and building at the same time when it's evolving around you is quite a tricky thing to do. But I've said to the team, we need to get better at just explaining, like the implied consent point, like this, because we actually have a slightly better story to tell than the kind of initial reactions here. So that's what we do. There's no waiting days to serve. They don't need to verify their ID again, and we keep them on the same payment cycle as well. So I think it's a slightly better process, but at the moment, I'm failing to explain that to the SFHA and others, and that's my fault, and I need to do better.
I think they probably heard you, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank, our guests, Neil Coolings and Denise Horsfall. I think it was an excellent session. We got a lot out of it. Yeah. Obviously, you're feedback to us, the figures that you mentioned, yeah, the fact, and take back, as you said, Mr. Cooling, real concerns about the short timescale in regards to the closures in the Glasgow job centres, and look forward to hearing back from you in regards to that and others. Yeah. So I just close the meeting and move into private session.